Hello everyone, today I'll be talking about arachidonic acid cascade and related medications. The learning outcome for this presentation is that you'll be able to learn about the arachidonic acid cascade, which is the target of many drugs that are very commonly used, as well as very familiar and very easily understood using this diagram. So let's start. First, I'm going to talk about where does arachidonic acid come from. Arachidonic acid comes from the cell membrane, so you can see the cell phospholipid bilayer. And membrane phospholipid basically means a component of membrane, cell membrane. So we have the membrane phospholipid turning into arachidonic acid with the help of phospholipase A2. From there, it can go on to two types of products, which are prostaglandin A2 with the help of cyclic oxygenase and 5-HPETE by the help of lipoxygenase. I like to call it the leukotriene pathway and the prostaglandin pathway. We'll be looking at the prostaglandin pathway first. So after arachidonic acid has been converted into prostaglandin A2, it rapidly changes into prostaglandin H2 because A2 is pretty unstable. From there, H2 can change into many different prostaglandins, which are illustrated over here. So prostaglandin I2, prostaglandin D2, prostaglandin E2, and thromboxane A2. Let's look at what they do briefly, one by one. So prostaglandin I2, also known as the prostacycline, it's gastric mucosa protective. It maintains good renal perfusion. It's also a vasodilator and prevents platelet aggregation, and it has a good cardiovascular profile. Prostaglandin D2, there's not much to say about D2, except that it's a bronchoconstrictor and a vasodilator. Prostaglandin E2 is very, very important because it induces bradykinin action and a major inducer of fever and pain. So it makes sense that we would want to inhibit this when we have fever or pain. It is gastric mucosa protective. It's a vasodilator. It's also a labor inducer in pregnant ladies, and it keeps PDA, a patent ductus arteriosus, patent in babies. Moving on to thromboxane A2. This is the so-called bad prostaglandin because it aggregates platelets, it vasoconstricts, bronchoconstricts, and it's a hypertensive agent, and it has a bad cardiovascular profile. So we're done with the prostaglandin. Moving on to the leukotriene pathway. From 5-HPETE, there are many products that come arising from it. I'm going to talk about the less important things first. The leukotriene B4, this is a very important less important things that I'm going to talk about from now on, but it attracts neutrophils. Okay, lipoxin A4, lipoxin B4. These lipoxins are kind of mysterious. We think that they are associated with anti-inflammatory as well as anti-anaphylactic actions. Okay. To the main products of leukotriene, leukotriene A4, leukotriene C4, leukotriene D4, and leukotriene E4, they all act mainly on the lungs. To zoom in into the bronchioles, let's imagine that this is a receptor for leukotrienes. I'm just going to explain how the leukotrienes work on the lungs. So what they do is that leukotrienes, let's say this is a leukotriene, and they will bind onto the leukotriene receptor. What happens is that this will cause bronchoconstriction. And now we're done with the arachidonic acid cascade. Simple enough. However, this chart or diagram can be used to explain a lot about the medications that are being used commonly right now. I'm going to talk about montelukast, which is a common anti-asthmatic drug. So back to the bronchioles of the lungs. What montelukast does is that it blocks the receptors for leukotrienes so that the leukotrienes cannot bind to the receptors and hence there is no bronchoconstriction. So it makes sense that montelukast is being used as a protective prophylaxis for asthmatic attacks. And it also makes sense that in acute stage of asthma, you don't use montelukast because it's too late, because the leukotrienes has already bound to the receptors already, and hence there is no action of montelukast. Okay, the next one I'm going to be talking about is the NSAIDs, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. They essentially block the COX, the cyclooxygenase enzyme. Some examples are aspirin, ibuprofen, and indomethacin. So, since we're talking about COX cyclooxygenase are enzymes, but you might have heard about COX-1 and COX-2, but you what exactly is the difference between them? So COX-1 is available all over the body, however COX-2 is available around parts of our body that are inflamed, which means that COX-2 is region-specific enzyme which is inducible, and most of the time it is pro-inflammatory. An example of drugs that would selectively block COX-2 is celecoxib. Now, some of you might have heard that these COX-2 inhibitors are very effective against inflammations because COX-2 selective inhibitors, they basically target specifically the inflammations. However, it's not all good about COX-2. There have been reports of increased incidences of heart attacks with the use of COX-2. Let's try and explain that. People have been trying to figure out why this happens, but now we have a theory to why this might be happening. So first, we think that endothelial cells have COX-2 receptors, whereas platelets have COX-1 receptors. In a normal situation, the arachidonic acid the pathway can go both ways, hence producing the same similar amounts or amounts that are in equilibrium of cardioprotective, prostaglandin I2, and cardio-damaging, thromboxane A2. However, in the presence of COX-2 inhibitor, the pathway towards prostaglandin I2 is blocked because the endothelial cell has been blocked by the COX-2 inhibitor. What happens is that all the arachidonic acid that was supposed to go this way, let's say 50% was supposed to go this way and 50% was supposed to go this way. However, since you've blocked here, only 10% can go this way and 90% has been going this way, which means you would increase the available amount of thromboxane 2 and decrease the amount of prostaglandin I2, which is cardioprotective. And hence, you have clots formation. Moving on. Now I'm going to talk a bit about steroids or corticosteroids. They have many, many actions, but one of them, I'm going to really simplify this, but it's going to affect cells to produce a protein called lipocortin 1. What this does is to block phospholipase A2, and therefore it prevents all the downstream reactions or products that are being produced. So it makes sense that steroids, corticosteroids like prednisolone, would greatly reduce inflammation. It also makes sense that when you take steroids, you might have stomach ulcers because, you see, prostaglandin I2 or the prostacycline has a gastric mucosa protective effect. When you give steroids, you're going to decrease all of this, everything, which means that the gastric protective mucosa, the gastric protective effect is diminished as well of the prostacycline. Moving on to prostaglandin E2 specific target. Indomethacin is an NSAID, and it can be used against labor, as well as the PDA. Because prostaglandin E2 mediates labor, indomethacin can be given as a tocolytic, which is to say that it can be used to abort a labor. In a sense that you would want to stop the labor so that you can keep the baby inside the mother's womb. You can also use indomethacin to shut the patent ductus arteriosus. Okay, that's all for now, and thank you very much. And if you liked it, please subscribe and see you later.